Good morning. Welcome to today's service. The theme for today is Christ the King. Before we start, can I just say this is the first time that I am using this format to record, so I hope it's going to go well. It might be a little bit clunky. Please bear with us. So we're going to start with our first hymn, Come People of the Risen King. Move myself out. There we go. This is King Charles III. What do we know about him? What do we know about him? It's time for a bit of a quiz. Okay, so an easy one to start because he's recently had a birthday. How old is King Charles? He is 74 years old. Now, this I didn't know, so I wonder if you know. What musical instrument does he play? In fact, he plays three. There's your clue. A little, you have to think. He plays the cello, the piano, and the trumpet. Interesting. I've never heard him play. I think I'd like to. Other than English, what language does he speak? Now, people who watch The Crown might know this one. He speaks Welsh. He learned it for when he became the Prince of Wales. Okay, what is his full name? It's got, I think it's four names. Ready? It's Charles, Philip, Arthur, George. And it's interesting to see those names and think of others we know with those names. How many children does he have? I think that's an easy one. He has two, William and Harry. And he has a degree from Cambridge. He's in fact the first king to have a degree. But what did he study? He studied archaeology, anthropology, and history at Trinity in Cambridge. Very well-read king we have. And now for our reading. Oh no. No one has seen God, but Jesus is exactly like him. Christ ranks higher than all the things that have been made. Through his power, all things were made, things in heaven and on earth, things seen and unseen, all powers, authorities, lords, and rulers. All things were made through Christ and for Christ. Christ was there before anything was made, and all things continue because of him. He is the head of the body. Body is the church. Everything comes from him, and he is the first one who was raised from death. So in all things, Jesus is most important. God was pleased for all of himself to live in Christ. And through Christ, God decided to bring all things back to himself again, things on earth and things in heaven. God made peace by using the blood of Christ's death on the cross. That reading came from the International Children's Bible. So we know a lot about King Charles, and we know a lot about Jesus as well. And in a lot of ways, they're very similar. We're going to come on that in a minute. Now I'm going to attempt to get the next hymn up, and I have to see if I can do this because I have to fiddle around as I couldn't get it onto my PowerPoint. So please bear with me. Let's see if I can do this. Nope. We want this one. Okay, let's see if this one works. Excellent. I get back to my PowerPoint and my slides. There we go. So this reading tells us that Jesus is the ruler of all things. Hang on. He is the Lord of Lords. There are many times in the Bible when he's referred to as a king. He's said to be the King of Kings, the King of Glory, and even the King of the Jews. Even when Jesus was being crucified, he was acknowledged as a king. A king is a chief ruler who has authority over a nation. They hold a nation together. This is exactly what Jesus does for us. He has authority over us and holds us together with common values and beliefs. Can anyone be a king? If I dressed a child up like this to be a king and asked them, as I will be doing in church, what would you do as a king? I'm expecting answers such as sweets every day instead of dinner, to be everybody wait on me, not have to go to school, maybe. Lots of things. Not necessarily the best ideas. So, what qualities do you think a good king needs? This Sunday is Shoebox Sunday, where we present the gifts we've brought for the children who receive the shoeboxes over abroad. We will present them at church and pray over them. So I thought about what gifts I could put in the shoebox for a king. Wisdom. A king needs to be wise. They need to make decisions that will help everyone. They need to know when to speak and act and when to stay silent. In the New Testament, we read about many times when Jesus told his followers how to act and how to behave. In Matthew 5, verse 5 to verse 3 to 12, Jesus taught the Sermon on the Mount, which gave us the Beatitudes. Many of those teach us how to behave. And then we have humility. A king needs to be humble. He needs to accept that he's no better than anyone else. Jesus was especially good at this. He didn't expect special treatment. He didn't expect people to treat him differently. He was always very humble and grateful when special things happened to him. If we look at the story of Mary and Martha, it's obvious that Jesus appreciated the perfume and love that Mary gave, but he didn't expect it to happen. He also showed his humility at the Last Supper when he washed the feet of his disciples. A king needs to be decisive. A king has to make decisions, and he has to be able to make those decisions, not just go, I don't know, what do you think? It's down to the king to make the decision. So Jesus had to be decisive too, and he was very decisive. When he preached on the hillside to the 5,000 people, he didn't worry that he didn't have enough food for them. He didn't ask all the others around him, what should we do? What do you think we can do? Like the disciples did. He said, what have we got? Let's use that. He made the decision and he trusted that it would be enough. Next one. Oh, hang on. That's not the next one. Ooh, what have I done? There we go. Protective. A king needs to be protective. He needs to keep his people safe. Sometimes in history, this has meant leading an army, but it doesn't have to be an army. Jesus protected the weak without an army. He used words. When in John 8, verse 1 to 11, we hear the story of Jesus stopping a woman from being stoned for her sins by asking, who is without sin? You can throw the stone. And knowing that no one truly is without sin, words can protect as much as action. And lastly, love. A king needs to love his country and the people in it, and he needs to want the best for them. Jesus loves all of us. He wants the best for all of us. So it's clear, looking at these qualities, that Jesus is the King of Kings, and we can trust him to lead us through our lives. Now, before we have our prayers, we're going to sing again. So back to me trying to find get the hymn to work. Please bear with me. We're going to sing Be Still. Hang on. I don't know what I've done. Please bear with me. I appear to have lost everything. Oh, hang on. Want the yes. Okay, we're back. So, oh. And now for the prayers. By Maggie.
Today, we're going to pray with Julian of Norwich, one of the church's saints, and with a hazelnut or a conker. I have a conker here, or a marble or a pebble or whatever you have that is a similar size. So it would be helpful if you have something to hold, maybe a nut, maybe a marble, a pebble, something that you have to hand as we pray together. So if you need to go and find something, pause the video and go and see what you can find that's a similar size to a hazelnut or a conker or a marble. And once you've found that, just hold it in your hand. Julian of Norwich lived from 1342 to 1460, so several hundred years ago. When she was 30 years old, she became very ill with a life-threatening illness, and she came very near to death. And while she was ill, she had several visions or showings, as she called them, which she understood to have come from God. She understood these showings not to just be for her, but to also be for all Christians. And she spent the next 20 years reflecting on these showings and writing down what she learned from them. One of the most famous parts of these visions is this one. I'm going to read you an extract now. And in this, God showed me a little thing the size of a hazelnut in the palm of my hand. And it was round as a ball. I looked at it with my mind's eye and thought, what can this be? And the answer came to me, it is all that is made. I wondered how it could last, for it was so small I thought it might suddenly have disappeared. And the answer in my mind was, it lasts and will last forever because God loves it. And everything exists in the same way by the love of God. In this little thing, I saw three properties. The first is that God made it. The second is that God loves it. And the third is that God cares for it. And so for our prayers today, we're going to take our conker or whatever you've managed to find and use it to think about what Julian of Norwich identifies for us. As we look at this small thing, it can help us to think about all that has been made and all that exists because of the love of God. So take your conker or your pebble or your small thing in your hand. And we're going to pray using those three properties that Julian identifies: that God made the world, God loves the world, and God cares for and sustains the world still today. So let's pray. First, as we look at our small thing in our hand, we remember the world which God made and of which we are part. In a moment of silence, I invite you to gaze at your conker or pebble or whatever you have and to pray for the world. You can pray for anything you like. Bring before God something in our world that you are concerned about today in this period of silence. Second, as we gaze at the small thing in our hands, we remember the world which God loves. In another moment of silence, I invite you to pray for your local neighbourhood, for the neighbours, friends and family members who you know and love, and who God knows and loves, that they might know the love of God with them today. Finally, then, as we gaze at the small thing in our hand, remembering that God made it, God loves it, and God cares for it, we pray for those who need care today. So in one more moment of silence, we're going to bring to God those who we know need God's care today, perhaps because they're ill or grieving for someone they love, perhaps because they're confused or lost, or maybe people who are living in a country where there is war and violence. Pick someone and pray that they would know God's care and sustenance today. Finally, we'll draw our prayers together in the words which Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you for those prayers, Maggie. They were beautiful. So, I'll just move this up. Right? This week, a little challenge before our final hymn. I want you to think like a king. I want you to put on your crown and act like a king. What quality are you going to show? Will you show protectiveness? Will you be decisive? Will you show humility? Or will you act with love? We're going to have our final hymn and then we will end with a blessing. Please bear with me again as I get the last hymn. And to finish, please join me in this final blessing. God of power, may the boldness of your spirit transform us. May the gentleness of your spirit lead us. May the gifts of your spirit equip us to serve and worship you now and always. Amen. Thank you for watching the service. I apologize again for any clunkiness. I hope you enjoyed it. See you again next Sunday. Goodbye.